And we want to read just two verses, verses 13 and 14. And I'll say, it is a wonderful privilege and an honor to be here in the Pentecostals of Boston one more time.
Amen.
Amen. To share fellowship, to share ministry. And I'm telling you, I like what I feel.
Amen.
Amen. The presence and the Spirit of God is here. I salute the angel of this house, your leader, Pastor Mac, and his wife. Amen. This is older. Amen. Put your hands together for your leader. And to all the members of his family, and to just all the saints, all the ministers, all the elders, all the guests. Amen. From Boston United Pentecostal Church. Amen. And of course, to my childhood friend, Sister Nicole in the back. Amen. God bless you. So good to have you. Amen. I salute everybody in their respective places. And it's an honor to be here one more time. Amen. Greetings to your youth leadership, to Sister Rayner. Amen. I can't believe just how time has just elapsed. You know, it was just April. It's just like yesterday that she asked me to be here for this. And it's already November almost. Amen. And now there's a transition in leadership. And I salute the successor. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Sister Tiffany and her team, Sister Brooke. And I know God is going to do great things. Amen.
Amen.
I'm believing there's a seamless transition. Exodus chapter 3, verses 13 to 14. And it says, and Moses said unto God, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, the God of your fathers hath sent me unto you. And they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them? And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you. The Lord bless you. You may be seated in the house of the Lord. It is the first night of the conference. We've got five services to get through. I'm going to ask the ministerials just to stay put. Stay put. Amen. Hallelujah. I don't want to have to call for you from too far. Amen. So stay where you are. Is there anybody who plays the organ? There's an organ player? Amen. Come on, organ player. But I want to begin tonight. I know that as the services progress, we will talk more about what God desires to do in our lives and just specific things that God desires to do for individuals, whether it's going to just be healing, deliverance, and whether it's going to just be transition, as I feel in my spirit. But tonight, I want to, as the Lord leads, begin this conference by talking about God. We want to talk about God. Amen. We want to just set the foundation tonight by talking about God and exalting God. Because I submit to us that if we will be charged, there's got to be a source from which we will pull power. And I propose to us that that spiritual source is our God. Somebody say, it is all about God.
It's all about God.
It is all about God. So tonight I want to speak to us on the subject, and it has been echoed in just every aspect of the service. The praise team was singing about it. Sister Venise and her team sang about it. Amen. And we've been talking about it. I want to speak to us tonight on the subject, my God is all that. I wish you could just look at somebody. You know. I mean, you're married, and you know when you tell girls about your husband, you say, you know, my husband is all that. I don't know how to do that neck thing. You know, I hope there's no brother in here that gets it perfect, though. But I wish you could just look at somebody right now and just tell them, just snap your fingers and, you know, twirl your neck if you can and say, my God is all that. And if you want, you can add in, my God is all that and a bag of chips. My God is all that.
God is all that.
Hallelujah. He's all that. See, I have come to discover that human beings are created to engage in two routes of relationship in the process of fulfilling the mandate that God has given to us, the mandate of conquest and subjection of the earth and replenishing the earth and filling the earth with a godly seed. There is the lateral route of relationship that we share with various creatures in our environment, particularly those who are on our same level, such as fellow human beings. And so being in the church warrants and requires that we enjoy two routes of relationship, because you've got to be able to relate with your brothers and your sisters.
Yes, sir.
You've got to learn how to network with people and to culture the higher virtues of love and peace and joy and forgiveness. And you don't know how to forgive until you have to deal with people. Amen. Who've got their varying personalities. And this is where long suffering also has got to be exhibited and tempered, so forth and so on. And the lateral route of relationship is required to get your name on the church register. You've got to become a part of the lateral fellowship before your name gets included on the church register. But then there is a very little attended and much ignored relationship, and that is the vertical relationship that we're called to engage in. And this is the relationship with our Creator, where all of the virtues that I mentioned earlier, the love, the joy, the peace, the long-suffering, the gentleness, the goodness, all of these are harvested from the vertical relationship that we've got to share with our God. See, whereas the lateral relationship gets your name on the church register, the church roster. And mind you, your name can be stricken off the church register. You know, there's some churches that if you don't pay your tithe 2 months in a row, you know you're going to get a letter to say that you've been disfellowshipped. Amen. Find somewhere else to go. Amen. But so your name can be taken off the church register. You can lose your place in the social existence of the church. But you see, when you get into the vertical relationship with God, this is the relationship that gets your name into the Lamb's Book of Life. I want to say to somebody here, I don't just want to have my name on a church register somewhere. I want to know that my name is in the Lamb's Book of Life. So I want to be in that vertical relationship. And this vertical relationship is also critical, because we can't have the true kind of success that we need to have. And this is not just the relationship that exists for the elderly to participate in, but many of us who are being used by God now, we entered into this relationship with God. For me, I can talk for myself. I got saved when I was 11 years old, January 1, 1991. I've not looked back since. Amen. And I can say, not that I've been perfect, but I've not looked back. Amen. And I can say to the young people in here that God is calling us to that vertical route of relationship. You see, we need this relationship, because there is the lateral relationship can only take you so far and no further, because there are certain situations that you can find yourself in, and you're trying to find help from everybody else to get you out of a rut, but everybody you turn to is also having their own situation. Anybody know what I'm talking about in here? But you see, I need to have a relationship with a Creator, a being that exists outside of the realms of my reality, who is not affected like I am affected by the storms and the turmoils and the chaos that this life can bring. I need a relationship with a God that is considered to be transcendent. He's above and beyond all human definition. He cannot be defined in words. There are no words in our vocabulary that is sufficient to really give an apt definition and description of this God that I'm talking about. I need a God that is immanent, that fills the entire universe. As a matter of fact, the entire universe exists within the realms of this God. I need a God who is sovereign, who controls and coordinates the entire course of this world. Because if I know that this God is directing my life, then I will have the confidence that I can't miss what he has for me. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
But what I like about God is, you see, my relationship with God is not based on his transcendence, because if he was only transcendent, above and beyond the realms of my universe, I would not be able to relate to him. He would be out of my scope altogether. If he was only immanent, the spiritual being within which the universe exists, he's too large for me to have audience with him. And if he's only sovereign, then he's just too mechanical for me. But what I like about this God is, even though he's all that, he is a condescending God, which means that he expresses himself. He understands that we can't come to where he is, so he comes to where we are. He expresses himself to human beings at their level and in their particular situation to offer them revelation to move them from where they are to closer to where he is. See, you gotta understand this, brothers and sisters, that even though God is absolute and he is never changing, he is described as the same yesterday and today and forever. But my knowledge of God and my understanding of God has got to be acquired through progressive revelation of God. See, there is no person in the universe that has a mind that is large enough and infinite enough to deal with a one-time revelation of the all-inclusive nature of God. So God has got to reveal himself to us progressively over time. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
You mean, brothers and sisters, so we are dealing with a God who reveals himself with us progressively. And this is why every now and then he's got to allow us to have some situations in our lives. Because as we will see as the message unfolds, that if there are no situations, there will be no revelation. Yeah, because we can't contain all of God. So God has got to create those situations in which he deposits just another aspect of his supreme revelation. So after every encounter with God, my knowledge of God and my revelation of God goes to another level. Can somebody say amen? Hear me, brothers and sisters. You will never ever go through a valley and come out the same way. Can I talk to us in here? Let me just stop to throw this in. For all those who are going through the valleys of their lives, you've been asking God, God, how could this be a part of your will? But while I was in my struggle back in the year 2013, and the Lord spoke to me, and he had me in Psalm chapter 23. And he said to me, look at the flow of the verses. You see, in verse 3, David says that the Lord leads me in the path of righteousness, which means God is leading me in the right path, or the best pathway to get me to where he needs me to be. But in verse 4, he says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Notice that David did not take an exit off the path of righteousness when he ended up in the valley of the shadow of death. And what that says to me is that even when we're walking in the right path, there will be the valley of the shadow of death. Somebody say amen. Ah. But note what happened in the flow of the verses. What I also noticed is that in the first 3 verses, before David went through the valley of the shadow of death, he was busy talking to everybody else about God. He was referencing God in third person language. You know, the Lord is my shepherd. He leadeth me. He does that. He does. Anybody notice that? But when he came through the valley of the shadow of death, there is something that transpired in the valley that took his attention off the lateral relationship. He stopped talking to people about God and started addressing God himself.
Hallelujah. And
when he came through the valley of the shadow of death, his revelation had so changed that now he began to address God in first person language, or second person language rather. Thou prepares a table before me. Thou anoints my head with oil. His language changed because his revelation of God changed. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Oh, I know God is about to help us in here tonight. So a lot of times we don't want to go through stuff in our lives, but I'm sorry to disappoint you and to overthrow your apple cart, but I gotta tell you this, that if you are gonna see God in a greater way than you see him now, this trouble that you are in is a necessary trouble. Somebody shout hallelujah in the house. Israel, brothers and sisters, Israel, the descendants of Abraham, and they only knew God, their only knowledge of God was through his relationship with their forefathers, with the progenitor of their nation, Abraham. And they talked about the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But there was something about those people who, become third and second generation Christians. You know, they have a tendency of talking about God as if he's only their parents' God, but not knowing him as their own God. And God wanted to get them to that place where they would recognize him as their own God, and they would have another revelation of God that would take him off the historical pages of being the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to the place where they can say, he is my God. I feel the Holy Ghost. And it is my desire that at the end of this message, everybody in here will not only say the Lord, but they will say my Lord. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Yeah. So the background to the text that we read is, the children of Israel are in Egyptian slavery, and they have longed for a move of God. They're in a situation where there is no form of divine worship to Jehovah God, because whenever God's people find themselves in servitude to another nation, another culture, they also find themselves subservient and bombarded by another set of gods, another set of spiritual atmosphere, another spiritual atmosphere, if you will. So they were oppressed not only by a political system in Egypt, but by a religious system with a multiplicity of gods. And their minds had become so degraded by the superstitions of Egypt, and they had no distinct notion of a divine being to whom they belong. Hear me, brothers and sisters. And because of this, because Egypt could take God out of their minds, they could get Israel to begin to see themselves as slaves. You know, hear me. Stop, you, the Holy Ghost in here. You know, they've got to do something to your mind. If any time you know the God that you serve, anytime you know whose you are, you tend to know who you are. When you know who you are, I serve a great, big, wonderful, victorious, glorious, and powerful God. You can never see yourself as a slave if you know the God that you serve. The Bible explains to us why they were, they stayed in slavery, and they were broken, not only in their bodies, but in spirit. Exodus 6 and verse 9 tells us that they were broken in spirit. They had anguish of spirit. In other words, they were cut so rock. They had shortness of breath. They were curtailed in spirit, which comes from the fact that they never had a revelation and a relationship with the God that continually charges their spirit. Hear me, young people. You don't want to go too long without having a contact with your God, without having an interaction with your God, because that's what's going to cause your batteries to get in the red. But every time you get into communication with God, there is something that you experience that causes you to be jolted, and you feel like I'm able to walk on for another week, another day, another month, another year. Shout hallelujah in the house.
Hallelujah.
So they had gone for so long, 400 years, without a revelation of God. 400 years, there was no coherent worship of God. And so even the man that God had called to deliver his people, Moses, needed to have an indication of whose he was and who he was. So you see, because they go hand in hand, you've got to know whose you are to know who you are. So Moses needed to have a reminder of whose he is and who he is. So he goes to God and he begins to ask God some questions. Who am I to be a deliverer? Who am I? How can I deliver this people when I don't have the strength? And I can hear somebody in here fighting with God. You've heard the call of God on your life, and you're trying to ask God, Lord, who am I to have that kind of a ministry? Who am I to be blessed with the gift of prophecy? And who am I to want to be on the praise team? And who am I to want to work in the youth ministry? And who am I? And who am I? Let me tell you who you are. You are a son of God with power and authority, because God has placed the Holy Ghost in you. And if you don't need the Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost is available to you right here, right now. Help me, Holy Ghost. You belong to God. You might as well just poke somebody gently in the side and tell them you belong to God. Come on. Poke them gently in the side and tell them you belong to God. I don't care what the devil's been trying to tell you and trying to, how he's trying to deceive you. You belong to God. So, amen. So the Lord had to remind Moses, Moses, don't you know whose hand you are in? You are telling me about your weaknesses and telling me about your shortcomings, how you can't speak and you can't do this. Who makes the mouth? Who gives speech? Who understands every language? Who does all of that? Isn't I the Lord? Is there anything that is too hard for me to do? I can do it. As a matter of fact, Moses, here's the deal. When I call you, don't you dare argue with me because I didn't call you because I am unaware of your inabilities. I called you because I'm aware of my abilities. Somebody will feel the Holy Ghost in the air. Somebody shout of praise in the house of God. God is not calling you because of your abilities. He's not calling you because of how pure your life has been. Matter of fact, I'll talk about that a little more on Saturday night, but God is calling you because he has enough power in himself to break you out of every chain and every bondage that the enemy has ever tried to get you in through your life. Somebody shout a praise unto God. So the next question Moses asked of God is, Lord, when I go to this people, they are going to ask me, what is the name of this God? You see, there are some things that God does in his word, and at face value, we may wonder why God does things this way. Why didn't God allow the children of Israel to just worship God right there in Egypt? Why God had to be so insistent that they leave the atmosphere of Egypt and go into the wilderness to worship? Why is it that God was so reluctant to give Moses a name when the people asked him for a name? You see, the people had become so cultured to measure gods and the ability of gods by the names that were ascribed to each god. So, for example, if an Israelite in Egypt heard the name Ra, the Egyptian god Ra, what they would think about is the god that is charged with the power to raise the sun. But they would not go to Ra if they needed healing in their bodies. Are you following me in the house of the Lord? So they had these gods who by their names were defined as what they were able to do. So they locked these gods into a box. So Ra, all you can do is raise the sun, but you can't do anything else. So I will come back to you in another 12 hours when I need the sun to be raised again. Or is it 24? I think my astrology is a little bit off here. Amen. I'll come back to you when I need the sun to be raised, but when I have the other needs of my life, I'm not going to come to you because your name is not reserved with any kind of power and authority in that arena. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. So this is why they would ask for a name. They would just stash God among the pantheons of the Egyptian gods, and he would just become another god that is only capable of one thing but not capable of anything else. Hear me, brothers and sisters. I don't need a God that is only going to be restricted to functioning in one area of my life. I mean, my life is so multifaceted that I need a God that is able to multitask. Do I have any witnesses in the house? Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost. My life gets too complicated for me to have a God that can't move around and maneuver and be able to take care of more than one thing at a time. I feel the Holy Ghost. Yeah. So they were asking for another noun name. God says, I will not give you a noun name because you're going to stash me into one corner of your life. And I don't want to become a God that is stashed in one compartment. Hear me, brothers and sisters in the house and young people. We got to understand this. We've got a way of stashing God in one compartment of our life. And we tell God that, God, I will pick you up on Sunday morning when I get ready to go to church, but right about now on Monday, I've got to look cool when I get to school, and this God thing ain't cool. So you know what, God? You can't come with me. I feel the Holy Ghost in here, but the devil is a liar. I want a God that's going to walk right up in that school room with me and give me revelations. I feel the Holy Ghost and help me bind the professor when he starts talking nonsense. Oh, y'all, and hear me in the house of the Lord tonight. That's the kind of God that I need. Hear me. Nouns, brothers and sisters, even in our day, nouns tend to be segmented and compartmentalized. Because when you hear the noun Obama, you think about politics. And when you hear the noun Bolt, Usain Bolt, you think about athletics. You never think about politics when you hear Usain Bolt or Obama for athletics. You don't think that because we tend to compartmentalize and lock them into boxes by virtue of a noun name. But God says, what I will do, Moses, is I will give you a verb for a name. Now listen, who gives a verb for a name? Somebody say, my God does that.
My God
gave him. He says, I will give you a verb for a name. Because you see, verbs cut across all categories. Because you see, the word run, for example, you can say Usain Bolt runs down the track. You can say Obama runs for office. You see, a verb has a way of cutting across everything and is applicable in every area. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. Yep. Somebody shout a glory praise in here.
Hallelujah.
So the Lord says, I'm going to give you a verb for a name because I want to be the God that has relevance in every area of the life of the children of Israel. I want to give you a verb for a name, moreover, because I'm a doing God. I'm the God that will be defined by what I do in your life. I will allow myself to be defined. He said, Moses, there is a grand name that is coming that is wrapped up in this verb that I'm giving you right now, but that noun will not be revealed until the fullness of time has come. But in the meantime, you can go ahead and ascribe a title based on what I do. I want to be a God that is defined by what I'm able to do in the lives of my people.
Amen.
I feel the Holy Ghost in here. So he gave Moses the title, the verb, I am that I am. I am. Now, brothers and sisters, when we consider I am in the English language, it is a verb that is in the simple present tense that denotes a current state. It denotes that something is currently happening. And that I am, amen, serves as an anchor for many expressions, you know. So I am running. I am good. I am healed. I am delivered. I am saved. I feel God in this place. So God says, you can feel free to fill in the blank. It's almost like I'm giving you a blank check, and anything that you need at a particular time, you just go ahead and fill it in on the lines. I am your healer. I am your deliverer. I am your friend. I am your rock. I am God. I am Jehovah. But when we begin to consider, so I am in the English language is a verb in the simple present tense. But when we deal with the word I am in the phrase I am in the Hebrew language, where God no doubt spoke to Moses because of his condescension, he won't speak to you in Spanish if your language is English. Am I talking to anybody in here? In the Hebrew language, the verb there is Ehia Asher Ehia, which is the same word that is also translated to become Jehovah. I feel the Holy Ghost in here. Now, when we consider, amen, Ehia Asher Ehia, in the depth of the Hebrew language, whereas it is restricted to the simple present tense, when it is used in the English language, when it is used in the Hebrew language, it is a verb in the imperfect tense, which means that it is not restricted to past, to present, or to the future. What it says is, it means that when it is interpreted fully, it means he which is what he shall be, who can be anything he wants to be without changing who he was. He who is, was, and who he was and is, will be. That's why he says that I am the same God yesterday, today, and forevermore. So you gotta hear me, brothers and sisters. What God wanted Israel to understand, and by extension, everybody who would read this text, is that I am the God that I'm not only able to multitask, I'm not only able to do more than one thing in your life, but I can do them simultaneously. So even while I am your deliverer, I can be your sustainer, your provider, your healer, and just about anything that can arise in your life. I am the God for every need that can ever arise. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In other words, there is no room for me to for any other God. And that's why, and I'm going to talk about this on Sunday, when I receive God, I am full. I never have. I'm full because every area of my life is covered. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost in here. You never hear that people are half or quarter or three-quarter with the Holy Ghost. We are full of the Holy Ghost because God desires to occupy every area of your life. Oh, Heavenly Holy Ghost, He can occupy every area of your life to begin to reveal to the children of Israel how powerful He was. This God said to Moses, I'm going to go back down with you into Egypt. Now that you have the revelation that I am the doing God, I'm going to go back down to Egypt with you, and I'm going to correct some wrongs that have been done, because Egypt has introduced my people to a pantheon of gods and told my people that these gods held control over their lives. So he says, I'm going back down to Egypt with you, and I'm going to whip some gods. I'm going to bring some gods and some principalities into subjection. Hear me, brothers and sisters. I want to challenge somebody to take this thought home with you, because here are some principalities and some powers and dark spirits and wicked spirits at work in your family, in your community, in your house. But I hear the Lord saying that I want to come home and set some things straight. I want to get that spirit out of that boy. I want to get that spirit out of that cancer has got to go when Jesus comes in the house. Somebody clap your hands and give the Lord a mighty shout of praise. Brothers and sisters, he went on down to Egypt with Moses, and he says, Moses, give me the cue anytime you're ready. Just stretch out the rod, and when you stretch the rod out, I'm going to judge one of the Egyptian gods every time you stretch the rod out. Moses stretched the rod out over the Nile River, and over the Nile River there was an Egyptian principality, a prince God called Happy, who was said to be the preserver of the waters. But when God stepped in, God turned the Nile into blood right under the statue of Happy. Blood was flowing all over Happy, and there was nothing Happy could do about it to turn the Nile back into pure water, because Happy is not God, the real Jehovah, He is God. Amen. Walk over to the statue of the land God called Ham, who called Hiccup, who was supposed to keep frogs from invading the land and invading their agriculture. And he brought frogs on the land. Jehovah God brought frogs that were crawling even over the statue of the God called Hiccup, and there was nothing Hiccup could do about it. He brought dust, turned dust into lice over the mane of the land God called Seb. There was nothing that Seb could do about it. He brought swarms of flies into the ear against the ear God called Shu, and there was nothing that Shu could do about it. He brought marine disease against Athos and Apis, the god of the bulls and the cattle, and there was nothing that Apis and Athos could do about getting rid of, amen, of the marine disease. He brought plagues of boils upon the people, and even when they prayed to their god of healing called Ned, there was nothing that Ned could do to reverse what Jehovah God had done. When he brought locusts, hail mingled with fire against their god of nature, and locusts, amen, against the god of the agriculture. And he brought darkness for 3 days against the god of the sun called Ra, the greatest god in Egypt. And for 3 days, Ra could not raise the sun, because Ra really has no power to raise the sun. I feel the Holy Ghost. And on the tenth plague, God walked into the house of the great God, the imperial deity of the land of Egypt, the man who had set himself up as a god, the Pharaoh. God walked into his house and said to the young Pharaoh, who was the next in line to become God, God killed a god, and there was nothing that God could do. I feel the Holy Ghost in here. But I'm so glad that I serve a God that is able to lay his body down and in 3 days to raise up from the grave.
saved and have no power for the blood-bought ones. Oh, glory, hallelujah to the Lamb, because Jesus rose up from the dead, and Jesus placed a power in my life that has given me resurrection ability. Somebody clap your hands and give the Lord a mighty shout of praise. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost in here. And let me tell you this, he's not done breaking principalities in the same way that he broke every principality in the land of Egypt. Let me tell you this, he's still breaking principality tonight. He is still breaking principality. He's still breaking dark spirits. I don't know what you're dealing with. I don't know what you're struggling with. I don't know what the name of it is. But let me tell you this, if you walk in there with the rod and stretch out the rod tonight, let me tell you the power of God. Oh, I feel God in here. The power of God that came down in Egypt is going to come down in your house, and every principality has got to go. Every demon has got to back up, because there is power. Hallelujah, in the name of Jesus. Let me run on and emphasize. So he began, and he said, Moses, now you're ready to write about progressive revelation. He brought him on back to the beginning. He catapulted Moses out of time into eternity. He brought him on back to the beginning when there was nothing, when the whole world that we now inhabit was a wasteland. It was without form and void, and darkness covered everywhere. And Moses picked up his pen and he began to write, and he says, in the beginning, God. Before there was anything else, there was God. He doesn't try to explain how God came into being, but he just wanted the world to know that before everything else was, God was. God is, was, and will be. I feel the Holy Ghost in here. I feel it in the Spirit. In the beginning, God. And the word used for God there is the word Elohim. And Elohim is one of the titles that God has came to be known by. And Elohim is one of the titles that has baffled the Trinitarian, because on the surface, the word Elohim is a plural noun. But in every time, in every context, the subject and verb agreement tend to show that Elohim, when referring to Jehovah God, is always used in a singular context. So it has baffled the Trinitarians because they would love to be able to say that there's more than one God. But at the end of the day, they've got to come to the conclusion that it's only one God. So how do they deal with this? They look at the word Elohim, and they say Elohim is therefore the majestic plural, which is the word that is only used by the command of kings. So when kings would give their edict, kings would never speak in a singular language. Kings would always speak in a plural term, because kings thought themselves as been vested with all the power of their dominion. But let me tell you this, that there is a great king that is above every king in whom everything. Let me preach on in here for a little while. They call it the intensive plural, which means that when God speaks, God has everything locked up in himself. In other words, anything that God ever desires to manifest already is existing in God. So when God speaks, he speaks as a conglomeration of everything that he desires to happen. So hear this, brothers and sisters. When God wanted light, know what God says. He says, let there be light. In other words, he spoke to himself and he said, light come out of me. When he wanted the earth to form, he said, let the earth come forth and the dirt came. So I feel God up in this place. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. And let me tell you this, brothers and sisters. Anytime God wants something to manifest in your life, he simply calls it out of himself. I feel God in here. You may be saying, I don't see it in me. I don't have it yet. I don't know how it's going to be. From the Lord, I said, I'm not calling it out of you. I'm calling it out of me. I feel the Holy Ghost. You don't have to see how it's going to happen, because it is in the Lord. Somebody clap your hands and give a shout of praise. My God, we spend our lives worrying about things. We're worrying about everything. But let me tell you this. If you can have this God called Elohim that has got everything in himself, you ain't got no need to worry about anything, because here's the deal. I give you one example. If you're worried about a car, amen. I don't know what materials they make car from these days. You know, there was a time when it was aluminum. Hear this. Where does aluminum come from? It comes from the soil. And where does the soil come from? It comes from the earth. And where does the earth come from? The earth comes out of God. Can I preach it here? If you want a house, a brick house, the brick came from the soil, which came from the earth, which everything that you could ever need. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost. Elohim, Elohim, Elohim. He's the kind of God that you need in your life. But he said, Moses, let me run on from there. Because I'm not only the Elohim God, but I want you to also tell the people that I am the El Elyon God. So Moses wrote in Genesis 14 and verse 18, and he told the world that the God is not only the creator God, but he is the most high God. In other words, I don't care how many other gods you have, but this one is the most high. This one is the one that's lifted high above every other God. Feel the Holy Ghost in here. This is the God you've got to look up to above and beyond everything else. That's why David said, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence comes my help. Because my help is coming from the El Elyon. Somebody shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. Moses, run on with me a little while here. He brought him on to Genesis 15:2 and showed him, Moses, not only am I El Elyon, but I am the Adonai God. I am the one that is a master. I'm the one that is the owner of everything. I am the supreme authority. I am the God that when I speak, my words become law. There is no other God that can overrule what I say. If I say you are healed, I don't care whose other report comes in that says you're not healed, but I believe the report of the Adonai. Somebody shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. Brought him on, brought him on, brought him on. He said, Moses, I am the El Shaddai. He brought him to the era of the promises, beginning with Abraham. And he said, Moses, in the era of promises, I reveal myself to Abraham as the El Shaddai, the Lord God Almighty. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. And I asked God, why did you use this title in the era of the promises? And the Lord said to me, he said, I gave promises that had no precedent. I gave people promises for things they had never seen happen in their lives. So I gave them the handle El Shaddai, the Lord God Almighty. Because you see, people are accustomed to promises being broken. I feel the Holy Ghost in here. But I wanted Job and Abraham and Isaac and Jacob to understand that when I make my promise, there is no failing economy that can stop me from bringing the promise to pass. Yes. There is no changing job market that can keep my promises out. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. I'm telling you, I'm telling you, I'm telling you. I don't know what kind of promises you've got from the Lord, but he's the El Shaddai God, and there is absolutely nothing in the world that can ever stop God from bringing the promise to pass. You may have to wait for 25 years, but God is going to come through. Somebody say, he's going to come through. Say, he's going to come through. He's going to come through. El Shaddai had the power to roll back the years of Abraham and gave him strength to produce seed in his old age. He had the power to rewind Sarah's biological clock. Ladies, don't rush to get with that. I feel the Holy Ghost in here. Let me borrow a word from your pastor's repertoire. Don't rush to get with that knucklehead talking about you getting old and you need somebody. God had the power to rewind Sarah's biological clock. I feel the Holy Ghost in here. The strength of producing. I say, God is able. He's able. Somebody say, he's able. Say, he's able. Give your neighbor an high five and say, God is able. Somebody is able. To do exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask the thing. He brought him on to Genesis 21 and he showed him that he is the Elohim God, which means the Lord God everlasting, which means that when I form a covenant with you, when I get into relationship with you, I'm in it for the long haul. You may change your mind, but I'm in it for the long haul. You may walk away, but I'm in it for the long haul. You might have looked back, but God says I'm in it for the long haul. He said, when I called you, I didn't change my mind. He said, matter of fact, when I brought you in the world, I had a thought that I was thinking toward you. I know you're messed up. I know you've not walked right. But I heard the Lord saying tonight that I know the thought that I'm thinking toward you, said the Lord. Because I am the Elohim God. I never change. So the thought that I had in the past, I know you're messed up. But I'm still thinking the same thought. I still want to bless you. I still want to use you. I still want to deliver. Somebody shout hallelujah. Better stay right there. Better stay right there. Somebody shout hallelujah. You might as well not touch your neighbor. Tell your neighbor. He's an all that God. Talk to somebody real quick. Tell them. Tell them he's an all that God. He's able. Bring it back up on the monitors, please. Thank you. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. We brought him further. The Genesis chapter 2, 14. Abraham walking up the hill. He has a son. He's wondering, what in the world am I going to tell Sarah about our only son when I get back down there? He's in need of a sacrifice. But the Lord showed up and told him, don't touch the boy. I feel the Holy Ghost in here, because I am the lamb for the sacrifice. Abraham lifted his voice and he said, your name is Jehovah Jireh. You are the Lord, my provider. Somebody shout hallelujah. Is there anybody in here? Anybody knows about your provider? To him. That's not all there is to him. In Exodus 15, 26, disease broke out, and the Lord told Moses, he said, tell the people that I will not bring the disease on you that I've allowed on the Egyptians, because I am Jehovah Rapha. I am the Lord that healeth thee. I'm going to pause it here right now. If there is anybody in the house right now that has any illness in your body, I give you Jehovah Rapha. He's a God that is able to heal every disease. Every sickness has got to go. Somebody shout yeah. Say yeah. Say yeah. My Lord, let me run on in here. But somebody shout all that. Say all that. But I gotta run on in here. I run on to Exodus 17 and found out that not only is he Jehovah Rapha, but he's Jehovah Nissi. He's the Lord my banner. He's the Lord my victory. I don't care what warfare is going on. Jehovah Nissi is the Lord my victory. I run on to Exodus 31 and found out he's Jehovah Enkadesh. The Lord has sanctified. The Lord has saved. When men say you couldn't be saved, when they say they wrote you off, God said, let me wash you. Let me cleanse you. Let me redeem you. Somebody say, yeah. Yeah. Say, yeah. Say, yeah. I run on. Jabez. I ran on to Judges and found out that he's Jehovah Shalom. He's the Lord my peace. I'm rest tonight because he's my peace. I ran on to Samuel, 1 Samuel 1. Found out he's Jehovah Sabaoth. He's the Lord that leads the army of Israel. I feel God in here. That's why he's able to say, a thousand shall fall at your side, and 10,000 at your right hand. He's a warrior God. He's a warrior God. Yes, he is. Somebody say, he's all that. He's all that. He's all that. He's all that. Run on with me. Run on with me. The Psalm 23. In Psalm 23, he's Jehovah Rohi. He's the Lord my shepherd, the one who leads me, the one who feeds me, the one who cares me, the one who protects me, the one who guides me. When they left me, he was always there. When they throw me off, he said, behold, I'm with you always. Jeremiah 23, he's Jehovah's sin canoe, he's the Lord my righteousness. To Ezekiel chapter 48, he's Jehovah Shammah, he's always with me, he's always there, he's always present, he's always on time, he's an on-time God.
Savior, in Jonah, the forgiving God, I feel
feel the Holy Ghost in here. In Malachi, he's a son of righteousness. I can't finish this. In Matthew, he's the King of Kings. In Mark, he's a great servant. In Luke, he's a perfect man. In John, he's just God. Somebody say yeah. Show you further how great God is. If you go to the alphabet, he's still all of that. Because the A tells me that he's an advocate. The B tells me he's a banner over me. The C tells me he's a champion of God in here. He's my comforter. The D tells me he's my deliverer. The E tells me he's my eternal life. The F tells me he's my faithful God. The G tells me he's a gift to my soul. The H tells me he's the head of all principality. Every power is under his feet. Somebody say yeah! Say yeah! Say yeah! The I tells me he's my intercessor. The J tell me he's a just one. The K tell me he's a keeper of my soul. The L tell me he's a Lamb of God, slain for my sin. The M tell me he's my maker. The N tell me he's the name above all names. The O tell me he's the Omega. The P tell me he's my Passover. The Q tell me he's my quickening spirit. Somebody say yeah! Say yeah! Say yeah! The R tell me he's my redeemer. The S, he's my sacrifice. The T, he's a tender plan. The U tell me he's unspeakable joy. The V tell me he's a true vine. The W tell me that he's a way. I feel God in here. The Y tell me he's a yes and the amen of my soul. The Z tell me he's the zeal of the Lord house. Somebody say yes. Give somebody high five. Give somebody high five. Give somebody high five. Somebody saying right now, but what if I don't remember what name to call it when I find my troubles on me, when trouble all around me? What do I call him when I can't remember the line? What do I call him when I can't remember what he is in every book of the Bible? What do I call him when I can't remember the alphabet? What do I call him when I can't remember all the compound names? What do I call him? I've got news for you. You ought to tell somebody right now. Tell them good news. Tell somebody good news. Tell them good news. Zechariah tells us. He says, in that day, the Lord shall be king over all the earth. The I am in Moses shall be the king over all the earth. And he says, in that day, there shall be one Lord. How many lords? Somebody say one Lord. And one name. I feel the Holy Ghost again. In other words, what he was saying was, there is a day coming when God is going to consolidate all the power into one name. All the power of the I am in one name. All the power. All the power of Elohim in one name. All the power of Adonai in one name. I feel a God in here.
stretching out in this place. I feel him stretching out. I feel the Holy Ghost. Let me tell you what the one name is. Paul said, for God, I feel the Holy Ghost has caused all the fullness of the Godhead to be locked in one name. And it is the name of Jesus. Somebody say Jesus. Every knee shall bow, of the things in heaven, the things in earth, and the things beneath the earth.